Hello students, welcome to UPG Pathshala. I am Professor D.N. Rao, Head Department of Biochemistry, All India Medical Science, New Delhi. Today I am discussing about various immunological techniques that have been exploited for knowing the importance of various diseases in an individual. The antigen-antibody reaction is the one very important, because the antigen should be multivalent, antibody should be divalent, and this combination gives rise to lattice formation, and this lattice formation is the one which finally gives the agglutination, whereas the precipitation reaction and activation of the complements. Before going to the various techniques, one should know what is called the titer of the antisera. This titer of the antisera finally reflects which is a method you are supposed to use it. And at the same time, one should know the affinity and avidity of the generated antibodies also, because the affinity and avidity finally dictates how sensitive is the assay we are using actually. And this antigen-antibody reaction can be seen in a semi-solid media or in a solid matrix, as well as another cellulose membrane, etc., by doing various immunoassays, etc. Next. And first of all, if you want to develop an antibody or monoclonal antibody or polyclonal antibody, the polyclonal antibody can be generated by injecting an antigen to any animal, and that animal starts producing the antibody. Whereas in the case of monoclonal antibodies, in the same way you have to do it for the monoclonal antibodies also, except in this case the spleen cells are fused with the myeloma cells, and you will get the hybrid molecule. This hybrid molecule starts synthesizing the monoclonal antibodies. There are various immunoassays are available commercially. This includes the radioimmunoassay, angioimmunoassay, fluorescence based immunoassay, and the complement fixation assay, and finally the flow cytometry, which is the most recent one, and that is the one which has been exploited various immunologists for day to day exercise. An immunoassay is the one which already I told you, this can be done by various methods, by using a precipitation reaction or agglutination reaction. In this case, the antibody or antigen is immobilized onto a semi-solid matrix, and once you treat with a biological fluid, you will get an antigen-antibody reaction in the form of precipitation or agglutination that can be seen with the naked eye, and this serves the one of the important or the earliest way of doing the immunoassays, etc. In the case of other sophisticated methods like radioimmunoassay or angioimmunoassay or fluorescence based immunoassay, the principle is the same in all these cases. We have to take a fixed amount of the antigen, fixed amount of the antibody, and fixed amount or any amount of the biological fluid. Once an antigen antibody is formed, this antigen antibody is treated with an unknown biological fluid which contains the putative or putative antigen, and once a computation comes and the amount of antigen that comes out in the biological fluid is directly proportional. Antigen antibody reaction is one of the versatile method which has been exploited for knowing the concentration of various biomolecules in the serum. And before going into the antigen antibody reaction, one should know the importance of antibody molecule as well as antigen. Antibodies are nothing but immunoglobulins, and there are glycoproteins, and they bind with the specific antigen by way of various non-covalent forces. This includes the van der Waals forces, electrostatic forces, hydrophobic forces. The affinity between the antigen-antibody complex is the criteria for knowing the concentration of various antigen in the biological fluids. Before doing any immunoassay, one should know the affinity and or avidity of the antibody. And affinity denotes the binding of an epitope with an antibody, whereas affinity it gives, since the protein or antigen contains a large number of epitopes, that cumulatively gives rise to avidity. And the development of any immunoassay by any individual depends upon how good the developed antibodies have affinity or avidity. Before going to the various immunological reaction that we come across, one should know the importance of the affinity and avidity between antigen and antibody.
Affinity deals with the binding of one epitope with an antibody molecules, whereas avidity deals with the multiple epitopes that are present in an antigen that react with a specific antibody. One can there are large number of methods available for measuring the concentration of antigen or antibody in the biological fluid. The first one is the agglutination reaction. In this case, the antigen is coated on the semi-particles, semi-conjugated particles, and these are RBC or bacteria or lattice particles. Now, when this antigen is coated on these semi-agglutinating particles, then it reacts with an antibody, then you see the agglutination. Agglutination is nothing but the formation of lattice between antigen and antibody combination. The first methodology which has been exploited is the presence of or the detection of HCG in urine of a pregnant woman using this agglutination reaction. The second one is the precipitation reaction. It is also same thing actually. The agglutination or precipitation is the same thing. And in this case, what is more important actually is if you want to see a precipitation reaction, the antigen should form a clumps with the antibody. This clumping nature is nothing but a precipitation or insoluble formation that leads to the antigen-antibody reaction, which is very important to know the concentration of antigen or antibody in a biological fluid.
The antigen-antibody reaction always gives rise to a precipitation reaction or agglutination reaction. This can be seen with a naked eye. Apart from this, if we want to develop a sensitive immunoassay, and where you can want to detect an antibody molecule or antigen at a very minute concentration, you have to use either radial immunodiffusion or immunoelectrophoresis, a Western blot. In the case of radial immunodiffusion, what is most important actually, you can, in this method, you can measure the concentration of the antigen by by putting an antigen in a well which is impregnated with an antibody. In the case of immunoelectrophoresis, the serum proteins are run on electrophoresis, and you can measure the concentration of individual serum proteins in a biological fluid. In the case of Western blot, what is more important actually, you can measure the concentration of various antigen of the bacteria or the viruses or the parasites by using a Western blot technique using an antibody as a probe.
The other method which has been widely used in various clinical chemistry laboratory or microbiology laboratory is a radial immunodiffusion. In this case, in a plate, agar is a molten agar is made into the plate, and various concentration of the antigen is added by punching a hole in the agar plate. Then this is treated with a specific amount of the antibody. Once you treat with specific amount of the antibody, depending upon the nature of the or concentration of the antigen, you get a radial diffusion curve actually. And you can draw a standard curve using a different concentration of the antigen. The diameter inside the well is directly proportional to the concentration of the antigen. So if you put an unknown sample in two wells, and you will know the diameter of the radial diffusion, and by measuring the diameter of the radial diffusion, you can measure the concentration of the antigen. This is also, even today, this method is being used by various microbiological laboratories as well as clinical biochemistry laboratory, and this will tell you a quantification of the antigen-antibody reaction. And second, other method which has also been routinely used in clinical biochemistry is the immunoelectrophoresis. In this case, this method is normally used for knowing the concentration of serum proteins. And in this case also, serum proteins are put on a plate or a paper, and it run an electrophoresis. And various proteins that are present in the serum are separated based on their charge as well as their molecular weight. And from this, you can see a large, almost 5 types of serum proteins in the blood of an individual. First starts with albumin, second is alpha globulins, beta globulins, and gamma globulin. These gamma globulins are nothing but the immunoglobulins actually. The concentration of each protein can be assessed by densitometry. From this, we can see in a diseased person what is the increase in concentration of a particular serum protein. And that can be measured by using a densitometry, and that will tell you and what type of disease the patient is suffering with. And another important method that is very important today, people are using the Western blot. And this is a technique which is used routinely for knowing the protein concentration of HIV infected people. In this case, the patient sera, or the what to do is the HIV virus lysate is run on electrophoresis, and HIV virus lysate gives rise to various proteins starting from envelope to various non-structural proteins. And once it is separated on the nitrocellulose paper, you have to treat the patient sera or react the patient sera with different proteins that are separated on the the nitrocellulose paper, and you get an antigen antibody complex. And this antigen antibody can be detected by using a secondary antibody linked with an enzyme or with a radioactive material. From this, we can find out whether a patient is sera is reacting with how many proteins of the HIV virus. That will tell you whether he is infected with recently or it is a chronic case, etc. How to generate the polyclonal antibodies in an unnatural host, that is means in a rabbit or a mouse or in a guinea pig, etc. The antigen is taken and it is emulsified with a complete French adjuvant. And once it is emulsified, complete French adjuvant, this mixture is given at multiple sites at the intramuscularly or intravenously to the various animals. And later, after a month, these are boosted with incomplete French adjuvant. And after boosting with incomplete French adjuvant, you can see the formation of polyclonal antisera in the animal. The difference between the French complete adjuvant and incomplete adjuvant is French complete adjuvant contains a preparation called mycobacteria, and that is very important for activation of the B cell clones or T cell clones that gives rise to a large number of antibody population inside. And another method which is really revolutionized the immunology is the preparation of monoclonal antibodies. In this case, similarly like protein antigen antisera generation, similarly the antigen is immunized to the mouse and in complete French adjuvant, initially in intramuscularly, later it is boosted with intraperitoneally, and the spleen cells are collected. And these spleen cells are fused with myeloma cells that contains the antibody producing capacity. Once the myeloma cells are fused with the spleen cells, you get a hybrid. And this hybrid is dispensed into 96 well plate. And each well contains a single clone. And this clone start producing the desired antibody. And depending upon your interest, you have to select that antibody which is useful to you. Later, if you want to have a high affinity antibody, this clone is injected to a same strain of mice and is produced as a ascites fluid. This ascites fluid is rich in high affinity, high titer antisera that can be exploited for various immunological purposes, etc.
Before doing any of the ELISA experiments or any of the immunological techniques, what is most important is the antibody titer, because many infected persons contains very high level of antibodies. You have to titrate the antibodies before reaching any of the immunological techniques. So what it can be done is you dilute the sera by twofold and see what is the highest concentration of the sera that still gives the antigen antibody reaction. That is how you can calculate the antibody titer. Once you know the antibody titer, it is easy to fix how to measure the concentration of antibody in the biological fluid using ELISA technique, radioimmunoassay technique, or fluorescence based technique, or flow cytometry, etc., etc. And in the case of ELISA, the only difference among all the techniques are all in the ELISA, there is an enzyme labeled. In the case of radioimmunoassay, the antigen is labeled with radioactivity. In the case of fluorescence-based test, the antigen is labeled with a fluorescent dye. In the case of flow cytometer, you can use the combination of all the three techniques which is suitable to you, etc.
In the case of enzyme immunoassay, this is one of the revolution that has made immunology, which is very easy to the patients. In this case, a fixed amount of antigen is mixed with a fixed amount of the antibody, and if you have a sera which contains unknown amount of the antigen, then once the fixed amount of antigen, a fixed amount of antibody reacts, gives rise to a complex. This complex is treated with the unknown amount of the serum and which contains a putative antigen, and there occurs a competition between the antigen antibody, and the what is happens actually, the antigen is comes out. Normally this antigen, when you are making a complex, that has to be labeled with an enzyme, so that the amount of labeled enzyme that has come into the circulation is directly proportional to the color of the reagent that we have subsequently used for measuring the enzyme activity, etc. And this is followed by another immunoassay, which is called the radioimmunoassay. This is the one first discovered. And in this case, there is no difference between the enzyme assay and radio assay. The only difference is, instead of the enzyme is labeled with an antigen antibody. In this case, the antigen or the antibody is labeled with radioactive material. And here again also, if you make a competition between the unknown sample with the antigen antibody complex, the amount of the label that is come out is directly proportional to the amount of the antigen antibody present in the serum, etc. This method, even though it is initially very powerful method, because of the hazardness of the radioactivity, and this method has been replaced by enzyme assay, which is very easy to use it. In the case of enzyme assay, a large amount of the enzyme turnover number, which can be exploited for measuring the concentration of various biological fluids. And the other method, which is again very popular, is a fluorescence-based immunoassay. This method is also same like the radioimmunoassay or enzyme assay. This is also same technology. Instead, the antigen or antibody is labeled with a fluorescent dye. And this fluorescent dye can be seen under a fluorescence microscopy. From this, we can find out what is the concentration of the antigen or antibody that is present in the tissue. This is normally used for knowing the concentration of unknown antigens or the presence of antibody in a biological fluid using the fluorescence microscopy, etc. And the other noted example, which is known for various immunologists, is the complement fixation assay. If the patient contains, or the biological fluid contains, an antibody specific for an antigen, that antigen antibody complex can be lysed by using a complement which is coming from the rabbit. So depending upon the lysis of the complement, which is comes as a button or pellet, that tells you whether the patient has an antibody specific for that antigen or not, which can be decided by using a complement immunoassay. The latest technology which is being revolutionized the immunology or serology is the flow cytometry. This is a wonderful technique where one can find out the number of receptors or number of antigens that are present on a single cell. What you have to use is an antibody labeled with a different dye or different fluorochrome, and each antibody is specific for a marker that is present on a single cell. From this, you can find out in a example wise, in a T cell, you can see the presence of CD3 molecule or CD4 molecule or CD8 molecule in a single population of the cell. This flow cytometry is one of the wonderful technique where you can see the presence of various biomarkers or immunological markers that are present on a single cell using an antibody specific as well as the dye which is specific for that color, etc. The other immunoassays which has been people have exploited are the competitive immunoassay, non-competitive immunoassay, homogeneous immunoassays, heterogeneous immunoassay. If the antigen is present in a big structure or having multiple antigen determinants, one can go directly a sandwich immunoassay where you can see the antigen antibody reaction using the multiple epitope that are present on antigen using a specific polyclonal serum. And in the case of competitive immunoassay, this is mostly used for heptanes, drugs or drug metabolites or small molecular weight compounds, where you can incubate the antibody on antigen with an unknown molecule and you get a competition. This competition directly gives you the amount of the heptane that is coming out, and that is directly proportional to the concentration of the solution, etc. So that's how the competitive immunoassay, sandwich immunoassay, and homogeneous immunoassay, and various heterogeneous immunoassay all have been used for the measuring the concentration of various antigen and antibody. In the case of homogeneous immunoassay, the advantage of homogeneous assay with heterogeneous immunoassay is you need not wash the solution directly and ELISA plates itself. You can wash with a suitable washing reagent, and whatever antigen antibody is present, that can be detected by using a second antibody that will link it with an enzyme, etc., or any other fluorochrome, etc. This is how the various immunoassays has been exploited for measuring the various concentration of the antigen antibody in a biological fluid using various immunological techniques, etc.
In the entire electrophoresis or various immunological techniques I talk to you, the most important conclusion I want to give to you is the antigen-antibody reaction is a non-covalent interaction, and the antigen should contain multivalents, whereas the antibody could be divalent. Then only the immunological reaction or serology can be achieved. The various methods which I told you time to time, that includes the agglutination reaction or the precipitation reaction or the radioimmunoassay, enzyme-assay, or fluorescence-based immunoassay, all have important events as far as the finding out the disease in a particular person. Sometimes the antibody helps you to know what type of disease that the person is suffering from. Sometimes you have to look at the antigen concentration coming from the parasite or from the virus. That will help you how much the parasites or virus the patient is harboring, etc. That's how it will help you to know the correct diagnosis using these immunological techniques. All these techniques has its own importance, because if we want to know the concentration of a very low concentration of antibody in a biological fluid or very low concentration of antigen biological fluid, you have to judiciously use either a flow cytometry or a fluorescence based immunoassay or enzyme based immunoassay or the radio or radio labeled immunoassay, which is up to your hands, etc. Out of all these methods, what is more important actually is the ELISA is very popular. This is because this test can be done in a small laboratory, because you require only ELISA plater, ELISA plate, and ELISA reader. And if you have these two, one can do the ELISA much more easily. In the case of if you want to know whether a person is suffering with the T cell defect, etc., what you have to do is you isolate the T cells from the patient or from a healthy person and stimulate polyclonally with any mitogen. If there is a proliferation is there, then the T cells are functional. If there is no proliferation, this means he doesn't have a functional T cells. That will tell you finally whether a person is suffering with any autoimmune diseases or T cell defects in a given individual. I thank you very much for having learned various immunological techniques, and I'm thankful to two of my students, Dr. Sujata Padak and Dr. Priyanka Verma, who helped me in making this module successful for the students. Thank you.